So good morning,
So, good
everyone,
morning,
and
everyone.
welcome to day two of this two-day virtual conference. We had quite a stimulating day of discussions yesterday, and some of the speakers are already here. I can see them on the screen. Starting off with Mr. Heblekar's opening session, which I thought was an engrossing session. We then moved on to Lieutenant General Rajesh Pant's 20-minute talk, plain speaking, as Suresh Bulusu mentioned later on during his thanking, plain speaking, and where he made some pertinent points. And then we moved on to what we all unanimously thought was the highlight of yesterday's program, the tabletop exercise, which was shepherded or led by Suresh Bulusu, Samir Aksekar, and of course Munjal Shroff, all accomplished actors by now, I think. So that will be an interesting video to watch once we get it ready. So we are here on day two. I'm happy to welcome all of you, and especially Professor N.K. Goyal, who is here. Good morning, sir. Nice to see you. And also Professor Kamakoti, I see you on the screen. So good morning and welcome. And Mr. Pavitran Rajan, who made a sterling no holds barred talk yesterday. So we look forward to more of that today. I'll briefly introduce Professor Goyal. Professor N.K. Goyal has been in the telecom field for 49 years. He's the chairman of TREMA, T-R-E-M-A, the Telecom Equipment Manufacturers Association of India, which was established in 1990. He's also the president of the CMAI Association of India and vice chairman of the International Telecom Union, APT India. Among other things, he's the member of the governing board in the Telecom Equipment and Services Export Promotion Council, which is associated with several industry associations, representing more than 180 government committees, groups, and very deeply associated with policy formulations on the Make in India, Digital India, Skill India, telecom, mobile, IT, education fields. Incidentally, Professor Goyal is the only person who's inaugurated and ribbon cut the world's largest consumer electronic show, the CES Las Vegas in the United States, for more than 10 years. So welcome, Mr. Goyal. We look forward to your talk. I think you have about 10 or 15 minutes, and after that we will move on. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks to organizers, ICSB, C3S, BII, on such an important topic, and particularly thankful to Mr. Pratap Heblekar, Rear Admiral Sanjeev Bala. I am able to see here Sasi and Suresh also. I am very happy to be sharing the panel with Professor Kamakoti, Pavitra Rajan from Sitara Group, and then Commodore L.R. Prakash, who is Director of CDAC, and Ms. Namrita Bijli Ahuja, if she is here. I think yesterday program I joined, and it was one of the wonderful session with lots of good speakers. And to me, it looks personally that nothing more can be said now. Whatever was to be said has already been said. But anyway, and Professor Kamakoti is known in India as the propagator for 5G domestic manufacturing. We are thankful to him, and it is because of him that we are seeing 5G, 4G coming to India for manufacturing. Having said that, we released a report last year on the security risk of Chinese OEM companies. And I will just speak for 4 points. 4 points are, one is, there are somebody who say that all countries have this, so why we are worried for China? And the so-called offer of no backdoor of Huawei, and the working style of China, and last is video surveillance risk. Now, coming to first point, people say, and the risk exists for all the countries, why are we worried only for China or Huawei jet? Our research answers are, number one, we share border with China, but not with USA or Japan or Korea or other countries. Secondly, China's companies are not a real private multinationals. Rather, they work as an instrument of the state. And if you say something for Huawei or ZTE or Hikvision or Jehua, you will get a statement from Chinese government rather than the company itself. Next point in this is, China, as we know now, has a China Intelligence Law 2017. And this law gives them sweeping authorities and powers. This law gives them legal ground to carry out their works, their studies, all individuals, whether inside China or outside China. These are the three reasons which make China separate than other countries. My point number two was, you usually get a statement from Huawei that we will not give you the back doors and don't worry, we are safe, we will be undertaking on this behalf. The problem is, we have a case of Vodafone Italy, where they said there was no backdoor. Backdoors were found out. And they were found out, then the company said, no, there are no backdrops. Then they were again confronted. Then they said, yes, it is there, but it is a standard industry practice to have the backdoors. And they promised to remove, and they didn't remove it for next 3-4 years. So I think the offer of no backdrop is not an offer acceptable from Chinese OEMs. The third point was the working style of Chinese companies. First, Chinese companies giving excessively low price, or predatory price. The prices of China companies are not linked to the cost of project, but they are linked to the strategic political decisions and the desire of China to have access to data and specific sites. In China, national champion, they have a scheme, which is very interesting scheme, and the scheme supports and include officially sanctioned or officially conducted corporate espionages designed to improve the competition of Chinese firms. This is something very surprising. Next point is that Chinese companies are known to hide their identity. We have cases in BSNL where Chinese companies quoted via Mexico, Israel. We all know the case of ZTE Cloud, which changed the name to Bell Cloud. And we also know that Huawei has been claimed officially as a private employee-owned company, but that is not the fact already on record. Last point was, with the increasing importance in India of video surveillance, CCTVs, we have a battle almost every week or so, because Hikvision and Dahua, which are the government of Chinese companies, through their companies or through their agents or subsidiaries or so, they are trying to make inroads in everywhere. And surprisingly, even in the case of JK police stations, the specifications are such that only they can meet. So this is a challenge we are doing. But I would like to compliment the government on the two orders they have given the last month. One about the equity investment from China, and second about the border countries, companies participating in Indian procurements. Thank you very much. With this, I finished in my time. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Goyal. You made your points, I think, quite clear and was quite succinct. So thank you. And you took those minutes given to you. And I think some of those points you've made are pertinent. I would request you to stay and listen to our program as it unwinds now. I'll pass it on to Samir Akseka. You're taking charge now for the debrief, Samir, before Munjal comes in with his session.
Yes, that's true, Sashi. I'll take over. So the agenda for my talk is basically just to give a quick update on yesterday's tabletop exercise that we had. What are the lessons we learned from that particular exercise? I'll just quickly put up a slide. We're coming up now. Okay, so lessons learned, the ransomware attack tabletop exercise that we did at Axis Healthcare yesterday. I think the first one that was amply clear is the impact of not paying attention to cybersecurity. I think that is something, a lesson that I see was taken away by many, many colleagues who attended and staff who attended, and even the actors themselves voiced out that the impact of not paying attention to cybersecurity is significant. Right? It can take down your organization, impact the organization on various fronts, right from your share price, your financial performance, from a trust, from the customer trust that they place in you, and right down to litigations and eventually closure of the organization. So it's take risk at your on your own, correct? That's what it amounts to. The second one which I observed was the effective risk management, or rather lack of, correct? Risk management is a key aspect that the Indian corporates, and more so the healthcare, really need to bring on board as a practice. The financial services sector really practices this well, but I think the other sectors really need to learn and bring on board risk management. The reason I say it is because you have precious resources at your disposal, correct? You have limited financial resources. You're dealing with human health, correct, which is very critical, correct? So you want to use these limited resources for maximum output and benefit. From a technology perspective, you want to use it to really secure your crown jewels, your hospital, correct? What is the absolute crown jewel for a hospital? Just like for a bank, it is your internet banking platform. For a hospital, it is your critical care, your ICU, your accident and emergency departments, correct? Which really bring in significant amount of revenue and your clients coming inside. So you have to put in place effective risk management practices so that you know what to prioritize, what not to prioritize. As was evident yesterday, the CIO Munjal had recommended a comprehensive plan to put cybersecurity measures in place, basic measures, not something advanced or way ahead of time. But these were not put in. So basically shows the failure of risk management here. Also a failure of risk failure from a leadership perspective as well, because whenever the tech leadership communicates, they need to speak the business language. So the way to get the attention of the board and the executive is to communicate in business terminology. So show them the risk of not doing something from a business perspective. That will get you faster approvals. The third one is communications. Effective communications, I think, was visible on and off. It was visible in terms of the interaction between the CEO and the CIO, but then it fell apart. So as soon as the ransomware or a problem happened, the CEO had the CIO on the speed dial, correct? He literally dialed Munjal and says, "What's going wrong? Correct, come over." So Munjal went over, had a look, did the initial diagnosis, but then sort of the plan sort of fell away, correct? Who do you engage? Which teams to be engaged? What notification to be done? How is it to be done? Do we have the basic formats in place? Like, these are our standard templates to be used for regulatory communication. These are the standard templates for media-wise, announcing to the media. Who would go and log complaints into the state cyber cell, the IT cells? So really, I think effective communication, it started with the top and then really withered away. So again, a takeaway for organizations is your communications need to be rock solid. Correct. It makes the difference between something that was okay versus really good. So that was the third one. And the fourth one, again, highlighted the need to get basics in place. And I'm a big proponent of simplicity and minimalism in cybersecurity. Right? You don't need to go trying to be brilliant in cybersecurity. Just avoid doing foolish mistakes is what I would say. Get the basics in place. And here, the one is culture. Start with culture. Get a cybersecurity culture in place in your organization. When I say culture, I really mean starting with training for your staff on how to recognize phishing attacks, training on terms of what is cybersecurity, what do you need to watch out to, what are the various types of threat a hospital can face. And this needs to start from the board level. The board needs to be aware of what cybersecurity is and correct, what is the impact of not having it in place, and then coming down to the next level of leadership and all the way down to the lowest rung on the hospital. So everyone needs to have a cybersecurity culture, and the leadership needs to walk the talk. You can't have the CEO clicking on a link thinking it's an anniversary announcement from marketing. No. So the leadership needs to walk the talk, and that's where the culture is extremely important. With healthcare, as always, is a regular assessment is what is said in cybersecurity. Always have a recurring assessment done, like a health checkup, and something which was evident was not done yet. Given that the hospital is continuing to ramp up locations after locations, you need to perform a regular assessment. So that will tell you what's wrong, what's your strengths, what's your weaknesses, where you need to put in funding, where you need to focus on more resources. So that would have come out in an assessment. And finally, technology foundational blocks. These are basic building blocks, starting with having an inventory in place of what all is there in your hospital. Basics. Right? Because once you have an inventory in place, then you know what software is running on. Once you know that, then you know, okay, what configuration is running on. Once you know what devices you have, you can lock down them from an identity perspective. You can do logging for these devices. So basics starts with inventory. Right? And then you go up the maturity scale, but really start with basics. And again, it was evident that some of these things were not there. As I said, is how many medical devices are impacted? Are they impacted? So I think these were the four key lessons, if the audience has to take away from the tabletop exercise in terms of lessons learned, what they should do back in their own organizations or as they talk in various webinars and conferences. I would request them to really highlight. So these are some of the key lessons that they should take away from a ransomware tabletop exercise. Suresh, with that, I'll hand it back to you. I'm not sure if you have anything else you would want to add to this.
Thanks, Samir. I think you covered it pretty well. Yeah, you know, we don't have to boil the ocean, but I think the interesting session was, while we try to make it light and easy for people to understand, I realized that there are a lot of people in the audience who are a lot more aware of the risks that are around us in whichever industry domain. And technology is only one vehicle. We have to look at people, we have to look at processes, we have to look at, as you mentioned, regular assessment. We have to make sure that we have a knowledge repository which has both the good practices and the bad practices, which will help to work closely with the government of India and the bodies to bring up something like a knowledge repository which can be used, leveraged rather, for benefits where you have issues such as this, and also as a model for training resources. Because if I remember Lieutenant General Pant also mentioning yesterday that resources are one of the things which are also a big issue for us when we want to fight a battle like cybersecurity. Yes. I'll add just one point before I turn it back to Mr. Nair. One is like to look at a full-fledged strategy. You know, today when we look at India, very diverse country, yes, we have the divide between the urban and the rural, but the bigger divide is between the private and the not private organizations. And when we look at it, cybersecurity, as you know, Samir, in the bank, when we worked there, we had very clear directions and then regulations and compliances. We had no choice but to comply with them. You know, we could have lost our jobs if we had not taken care of that. And so that matters in banks, especially MNC banks. We have looked at the government banks and the national banks now. But when you look at the other domain, whether it is manufacturing or it is healthcare, especially in healthcare, it kind of amazes me that people live in a sense of denial, saying that nothing has happened so far, so we are safe. It is very much like the way we behave with respect to COVID-19 today. You know, we think that it's going to pass by me and nothing's going to happen. But I think we are going to face severe repercussions if we don't step in now and take adequate care. So one is to have a strategy which can be rolled out, policies and those kind of things, and unless people are mandated, I remember having a conversation with Commander Prakash, and he said, unless people are mandated, they are not going to follow. In BFSA, they follow because you guys were mandated. So with that said, I think it was a good session. We enjoyed performing the tabletop exercise for that, and I found that there was very good comments. Thank you all for being a part of that. Ms. Mack, back to you.